given process arrival and CPU cycle. The average turnaround time of these processes will be what on the basis of which algorithm? With slice of 4 milliseconds. That means they are talking about the round robin scheduling algorithm. Okay, so process A, B, C, D arrival time is 0, 1, 2, 3. Simple. So A will come at 0 and it will run for 4 milliseconds, and then process B will come and it will run from 4 to 8 and process B will complete. Then C will come from 8 to 12. Okay, then D will come from 12 to 16. Again, same processes will come and it will run from 16 to 20 and this process completes. Okay, then C will come and C will run from 20 to 24. That means next process will come D, and D will run only for 1 millisecond, because the total time for D is 5 and we have already run this for 4 milliseconds. That means only 1 millisecond are required to complete process D. So D process will also complete. Now C require only 1 millisecond to run because we have already completed 8 milliseconds for this process. So only 1 millisecond is required, but 25 to 26, this process C will run. Now we need to find out the average turnaround time. So average turnaround time of these processes will be simply completion time minus arrival time. The completion time of A is 20 and the arrival time was 0. That means the turnaround time is 20. For process B, arrival time was A and the completion time was 8. That means 8 minus 1, that is 7 is the turnaround time. Then process C will come and C came at 2 and it has completed at 26. That means 24 will be the average turnaround time. And D process has come at 3 and completed at 25. That means 25 minus 23, that means 22. Divide by how many processes are there? 4. That means this will be 20 plus 20 plus 20, 60. 60 plus 13 is 73. 73 divided by 4, that means 1 and 18.10. That means 18.25 milliseconds. This will be the average turnaround time of these processes using round robin algorithm with 4 milliseconds of time quantum. Okay, next question is on the page replacement algorithms, and they are asking about the number of page faults using FIFO and LRU. So how many frames we have? We have 2 page frames only. So let us see with FIFO, using FIFO with 2 page frames, and the page string is this. Okay, A is a page fault, B is a page fault. Okay, A is a page fault, B is a page fault, A is not a page fault, C is a page fault, and it will replace A. Okay, then A is page fault and it will replace B. Then again B is a page fault and it will replace C. Then again D is a page fault and it will replace A. Then B is not a page fault, A is a page fault and it will replace A. Okay, then C is a page fault and it will replace D. And then D is a page fault and it will replace A. First come, first in, first out. Okay, so number of page fault in FIFO is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, let us see in LRU, least recently used. So in this case, A is a page fault, B is a page fault. Okay, then A is not a page fault, then C will come and it will replace which one? Least recently used. So B jo hai, wo hai least recently used. Then A is not a page fault because A is already in the memory. B is a page fault and it will replace C because A is used recently and C is least recently used. Then D is a page fault and it will replace which one? A. Because B just used and A is the least recently used in these two. Then B is not a page fault. A is a page fault and it will replace D. Then C is a page fault and it will replace which one? B. Okay, then D is a page fault and it will replace A. Okay, so finally in memory we will have DC in both cases. So number of page fault in LRU will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So number of page fault in LRU is 8. Yes, so answer is C. Next question is saying, suppose S and Q are two semaphore initialized to 1. Okay, they are initialized to 1, s equals to 1 and q equals to 1. P1 and P2 are two processes which are sharing the same resources. P1 has a statement these, P2 has a statement these. Their execution may sometimes lead to an undesirable situation called what? So wait is, once this executes, and this will also execute because they are in parallelly. So both are in the next next statement. Now we need, this process wants to access Q and this process want to access S. But both process will be blocked. Because, why? Because this P1 process is demanding for Q and Q is already blocked by process P2. Okay. And process P1 is demanding Q, which is already blocked by P2. And in this line, process P2 is waiting for S, which is already blocked by process P1. So P1 is waiting for P2 to release Q and P2 is waiting for P1 to release S. Right, I hope you understood what I said, because the S and Q are two semaphores. When you apply S of wait operation on any semaphore, it will decrease the value of semaphore by 1 and then it will check if the value is less than 0, then it will be blocked. If the value is 0 or greater than 0, then it will keep running. Okay, in this case, what will happen? I hope you know the definition of wait. When you apply wait operation on a semaphore, simply first you decrement the value and then you check if S is less than 0. Okay, then wait. Okay, otherwise going to the next statement. Okay, but this will be executed successfully. This will be executed successfully. But when you come to this statement, this process will be blocked. Why? Because the value of Q is 0. When you decrease the value of 0 minus minus, it will become minus 1. So this value is less than 0. That means you have to wait. This process will be waiting. Now this statement will be executed. Again, same situation. 0 minus minus means minus 1. Okay, again this process will have to wait. That means this is the deadlock. An operating system using Banker's algorithm for deadlock avoidance has the dedicated devices, and maximum resources requirement are 4, 5 and 8. There are two states of the allocation of the devices as follows. Which of the following is correct? We have to check for the safe state and unsafe state for both of these. Okay, let us try. So we have three processes, P1, P2 and P3, and we have matrices like, I hope you know, max, allocated, request and then available. Okay, maximum requirements are 4, 5, 8. Allocated are 2, 3, 4. More requests are 4 minus 2, 5 minus 3, 2, 8 minus 4 is 4. Available are what? Banker's algorithm, 10 dedicated devices. We have 10 resources total, and out of 10 we have allocated 2 plus 3, 6, 6 plus 2, 3 plus 5, 5 plus 4, 10. So, 5 plus 4, 9. So, out of 10 we have allocated 9, that means we have only one available resource. And with one available resource, we cannot fulfill the requirement of any of these processes. Okay, that means the state 1 is unsafe state. Let us try with second state. Okay, in second state, what will happen? Let us see. So we have P1, P2, P3, and the maximum requirements are 4, 5, 8, same, but the allocation matrix differs. Allocation matrix is 0 to 4. Okay, this is allocated, this is max, and more requests are 4, 5 minus 2 is 3, and 8 minus 4 is 4. Available are, out of 10 we have allocated 6, so we have 10 minus 6, that means 4 are available right now. So with these 4 resources we can fulfill the requirement of these two processes. Okay, either this or this, you can fulfill request of anyone. So let us fulfill the request of this one, P1. So process P1 will execute and it will release the resources 4. Okay, it will release 4 resources, then we can execute this process P3. Okay, or we can execute P2 also. Right, we can execute P2 or P3. So there will be two safe sequence in this. P1, P2, P3, or P1, P3, P2, and then there will be two more safe sequence. We can, because with 4 available resources, you can fulfill the requirement of any of these processes. So there can be many safe sequence Okay, safe sequence cannot be unique. It may be unique or it may not be unique. There may be many number of safe sequences for a single set of processes. For example, other safe sequences can be, we can start with P2 also. Here we are starting P1, we can start P2 also. We execute P2, then we will have five resources, we can execute any of these. So P2, P1, P3, or P2, P3, P1, or we can execute P3 first also. P3, P1, P2, P3, P2, P1. That means there will be total six safe sequences. All the sequences will be safe sequences for these processes. Okay, because the allocation matrix is differing here, that means that's why this state is safe state. So state 1 is unsafe and state 2 is safe state. So the answer is state 1 is unsafe state and state 2 is safe state. Answer is 1. Let the time taken to switch between user mode and kernel mode of execution be T1, while time taken to switch between two processes be T2. Which of the following is correct? To answer this question, you need to understand how we switch from user mode to kernel mode. So let us say a user process is executing and user process executes a system call. For example, let us say you are using a printf function in your program, and this printf function is library function which is internally calling write system call. Okay, this is the write system call. Once you make a system call in your program, then you have to move from user mode to kernel mode, because all the system calls are executed in the kernel mode, because system calls are nothing but the part of the operating system. This is the code of operating system. So when you are executing the code of operating system, you need to move from kernel user mode to kernel mode. And to do this, we simply change a bit with the mode, which is called the mode bit. So there will be a trap. Trap is an instruction, and you will change the mode bit from 1 to 0. Okay, if you want to move from user mode to kernel mode, you simply need to make the mode bit 0. Okay, then in kernel mode, you will execute the system call. Simply, the system call is executed in the kernel mode. Okay, remember this, system calls are executed in the kernel mode. This is very simple interview question. Okay, then again, if you want to move from after executing the system call, you will get the result. And when you return from the system call, you will simply be in the user mode. So if you want to move from kernel mode to user mode, you need to simply change a mode bit from 0 to 1. Okay, then you will be in the user mode. User program will never know that what fraction of the program executed in the kernel mode. It will be executed in the kernel mode, and again you will be back into the user mode. So this will be the time taken to move from user mode to kernel mode. So let us see what happens when you switch from one process to another process. Let us say process P0 was executing and at this point of time, when this process P0 was executing, we had an interrupt or system call. Once you have an interrupt or system call, you will move to the, where you will move? You will move to the kernel mode. Okay, that means now operating system will start executing. Operating system process will start executing. Actually, operating system processes are executing all the time in the system. That's why operating system is running. So when there is a system call, you will simply save the state of the process P0 into the PCB. Then you will reload the state of the PCB of process P1, because now you want to switch from process P0 to P1. That is called the context switch. But before switching from process P0 to P1, you need to save the data of process P0, because you will come back to process P0. Then you want to be sure from where you left the functions, you need to start from there only. So then again, you will start executing the process P1 from here. And when you are executing process P1, you again had the interrupt. That means you want to move from P1 to P0. So context switch is nothing but, for example, let us say when the time quantum expires of a process, let us say P0, let us say time quantum was 2 nanoseconds. So after 2 nanoseconds, there will be a context switch after P0 to P1 or P1 to P2 or P2 to then again P0. So let us say there are three processes, P0, P1, P2. So after 2 nanoseconds, there will be a context switch from P0 to P1. Then again, after the time quantum of this process finishes, again we will move back to the process P0. Then we will save the PCB of process P1 and we will reload the PCB of process P0. That means here we are switching from P1 to P0 and here we are switching from P0 to P1. So in this particular time, the system will be in idle state. Okay, processor will not be doing anything because we are switching from one process to another process. There is no process executing on the CPU. So this is the hell lot of time taken, because first you are moving from user mode to kernel mode, then you are doing something in the kernel mode, then again you are moving from kernel mode to user mode. So if let us say T1 is the time taken to move from user mode to kernel mode and T2 is the time taken to switch between two processes, then definitely the time taken by T1, T2 will be more than the T1. Because if you want to move from user mode to kernel mode, you simply need to set mode bit from 0 to 1. Okay, if mode bit is 0, that means you are running in the kernel mode. If mode bit is 1, that means you are running in the kernel mode. This is kernel mode and this is user mode. Okay, if mode bit is 0, that means that you are running in the kernel mode. If bit is 1, you are running in the user mode. So it will take very less time. But switching from one process to another, you have seen the diagram, it will take a lot of time. So T2 is greater than the T1. So working set model is used to memory management to implement the concept of what? So before understanding this, you need to understand the thrashing. So in thrashing, what happens is when you try to actually increase the degree of multiprogramming, increase the degree of multiprogramming means you are loading more processes into the main memory. More number of processes in main memory, the more degree of multiprogramming. Okay, simply multiprogramming means how many processes you can store into the main memory. If you have two processes in main memory, that means the degree of multiprogramming is 2. When you bring more processes into the main memory, that means you are increasing the degree of multiprogramming. So in paging system, what happens is in demand paging, you simply load a page of a process into the main memory whenever it is required. So it may happen that we may have multiple pages of multiple processes into the main memory at the same time. When the memory will become full, for example, let us say this is your memory. Okay, these are the pages into the main memory. Okay, this means process P1, page 1 of process P1. This means process page 1 of process P2. This means page 2 of process P2, and this means page 3 of process P1. Okay, second number is indicating the process number and first indicating the page number. So one process can have multiple pages and we can have multiple processes into the main memory. If a new process comes, let us say we are executing this page, okay, and we require second page of the same process. Okay, that means we require, let us say, second page of this process is already into the main memory. Let us say we require fourth page of this process P41. So what we have to do is, when we want to execute P41, we have to bring it to the main memory. But in main memory, we do not have space. That means we need to replace one of the pages from the main memory. This will be decided by the page replacement algorithms. So page replacement algorithm will work and it will replace one of the pages from the main memory. Let us say this page is replaced by P41. Okay, so this page is replaced by, this is a page fault. When a page is not found into a main memory, this is a page fault. So when a page fault occurs, you need to bring that page from hard disk to main memory. So you are bringing that page from hard disk to main memory and you're replacing one of the pages. So once you actually started executing this page, once you were executing this page, you will require P21. Okay, when you are executing this page, you require page number 2 of process P1 to execute this page. Okay, maybe there is a function call from this page to this page. So you cannot execute this page without this page. So you need to bring this page into the main memory. Again, let us say P21 replaced this P41. Let us say here we replaced P41. Again, P21 will replace P41. So again, same thing. To execute this, you need P41. So what is happening? Most of the time, CPU is busy in swapping out and swapping in the pages from hard disk to main memory. Okay, this is called the swapping. When you are swapping out pages into the hard disk and then swapping in from hard disk to main memory. Okay, this is called swapping. So most of the time, CPU will spend the time in page replacement and page fault service time. So most of the time, CPU is doing the page fault service. It is not executing any process. This is called the thrashing. And thrashing is a situation when after reaching a particular peak of degree of multiprogramming, let us say we have highest degree of multiprogramming, after a time the degree of multiprogramming will keep reducing because CPU cannot execute more processes because there are a lot of page faults. Okay, this is optimal degree of multiprogramming. After this, the degree of multiprogramming will keep decreasing. So this working set model is actually the solution of thrashing. In working set model, what we do is, let us say you have this is the set of pages which you have to execute. Okay, these are the set of pages you want to execute. So let us say number of frames in memory is 3. Okay, so at one time you can keep only 3 pages into the main memory. This will be the page faults. So currently this is the working set model actually. Okay, this is currently whatever the pages are in the memory, this is a working set. Like this you will have many working sets in the in a particular moment of time. So summation of all those working sets, let us say it is D. Okay, if the summation of all working sets is less than the number of memory allocated, then there will not be page faults. If the size of working set is greater than the memory available, then there will be lot of pages, because some of the pages will not be in main memory, because the size of the main memory is less than the required number of frames in the main memory. So in this case, what will happen is there will be lot of page faults, so there may be thrashing. So working set model actually restricts the working set size to D, and D is the set summation of all the working sets. So this is actually working set model is the solution of thrashing. And when I explained thrashing in operating system, I explained it into the details. You can watch my lectures on operating system if you want to understand thrashing and working set model in details. Okay, so this is what I told you. So the accuracy of the working set model is dependent on the value of parameter of A. A is too large, then working set may overlap. And on the other hand, if smaller value of A, the locality might not be covered entirely. So A is that value which I already told you. What is A? A is the size of this, currently how many pages are into the main memory. So A equals to 3 here. 1, 2, 3 are already into the main memory. Then 4 will come, and 4 will replace what? 4 will replace, let us say we are using FIFO algorithm. Then 4 will replace this and this. So working set now will becomes 4, 2, 3. So this is the working set now. Again 5 will come, and 5 will replace one of these pages, and then working set will become like this. Okay, so this is A. So if D is the total demand for frames and WSSI is the working set size for process I, then the summation of all working sets is D. Now if M is the number of frames available in the memory, there are two possibilities. D is greater than M, then total demand exceeds the number of frames. Matlab aapko let us say 5 frames ki demand hai and number of frames available are 4. If 5 is greater than 4, if number of frames require is greater than the number of available frames, then there will be page fault definitely. So there will occur as some process would not get enough frames. Thrashing will occur in this case. If D is less than equals to M, then there will not be no thrashing. So we want to restrict our working set size to D. Okay, if there are enough extra frames, then some more processes can be loaded into the main memory. So working set size, working set model is the solution of thrashing. So next question is same. We solved this question earlier. We have block size of 1 KB and the disk address is of 4 bytes. And what is the maximum file size of the inode? Contains 10 direct blocks, 1 single indirect and 1 double indirect and 1 triple indirect. So we have to find out the size of the file. So how we find out the size of the file, you already know. Number of pointers in a block. How many number of pointers are there in one block? Simple. Size of the block divided by size of the pointer. 1 KB means 1024 bytes. Divide by 4, that means 256 pointers can be there in one block. Okay, we can store 256 pointers in one block, and each pointer is of 4 byte. 4 into 256 is 1024 byte. So the size is like this. This is inode, and in this inode we have how many contains 10 direct pointers. So we have direct pointers 10. Okay, so these are the 10 direct pointers, 0, 1, 2 and then till 9. Okay, 10 direct pointers. That means in these blocks we are storing the address of direct block. This is data block, address of a data block. Okay, so these are the 10 direct pointers. Then we have single indirect pointers. In single indirect pointer we are storing the address of the indirect block. Okay, this is, we are storing the address of indirect block, which is there is a block in which we have 256 pointers. We have the address of a block in which we have the address of 256 blocks. Okay, this is, let us say, data block 0, this is 1, till then, like this, we have 255 blocks pointed by this particular block. In this, we have 256 pointers, and each pointer is pointing to one data block. These are the data blocks. Here we had the pointer to directly data block, but here we have a pointer to a block in which we have the addresses of other data blocks. In double indirect, what will happen? In double indirect, we will have a address of a block in which we will have the addresses of other blocks, 256 blocks, because one block can hold the addresses of 256 blocks, and these 256 blocks are having the addresses of data blocks, because this is double indirect. In this, we have the address of 256 data blocks. Like this, this is also pointing to 256 data blocks. This is also pointing to 256 data blocks. That means total we have 256 into 256 pointers, and each pointer is block pointing to a block. So each pointer will give you one block size, that is 1 KB. Then we have triple indirect, and in triple indirect we have a block in which we have 256 pointers, and each pointer is pointing to one block, and each block is pointing to a block which is actually pointing to data. So there will be three levels. Okay, so size of the file will be like this. In this case, the size of the file will be 10 direct pointers. That means we have 10 direct pointers. 10, every pointer is giving us one block. So each pointer is the address of one block. So 10 pointers will give you 10 blocks. Okay, so you have 10 blocks of data, plus then one indirect block. That means you will have 2 to the power 8. Okay, one single indirect, 2 to the power 8 pointers, and each pointer is pointing to one block, and block size is 2 to the power 10, that is 1 KB, plus double indirect. Double indirect will give you 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 10. Then triple indirect, 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 10. So this will be the size of the file. Finally, this will be 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 10 into 1 KB. Let us say this is simply, we will not assume this. Let us say if we have the answer 8 plus 8 plus 8, I told you we can take maximum value or we can consider this. We have to look at the options. We will see with both ways. So the largest value in this is 8 plus 8 plus 8, that is 24 plus 10 is 2 to the power 34. That means the size of the file can be, maximum size of the file can be in this 16 GB. Okay, so we have 16 GB in the option. How many we can have with this double pointers? Double pointer will give you 8 plus 8 16, 16 plus 10 26, 2 to the power 26. That means 64 MB. Single indirect is giving you 2 to the power 18. That means 256 KB. Okay, it is giving you 256 KB. And single indirect is giving you 10 KB. So total file size you can count like this: 16 GB plus 6 MB plus 256 KB plus 10 KB. That means 266 KB. So actually we will not consider all these things. Okay, so answer will be 16 GB. That's why we actually neglect these smaller values. We only look at the triple indirect. Triple indirect can give you. So the direct way of solving this question is like this. Simply look at the if you want to save your time, simply do like this. Look at the triple, what is the maximum level? Maximum level is, if you have double indirect, just calculate for the double indirect. If you have triple indirect also, then calculate only for triple indirect. If you have fourth direct, then you simply calculate for fourth direct. So you have one triple indirect. So we know that the number of pointers in a block can be, number of pointers per block can be the size of the block divided by size of the pointer. That means 2 to the power 10 divided by 2 to the power 2. That means 2 to the power 8 pointers can be there in one block. So for triple indirect, simply do like this. For triple indirect, multiply by 3 times. 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 2, 8 into 2 to the power 8. So these are the number of pointers in triple indirect. Into each pointer will give you one block. So into 1 KB. This will be simply 2 to the power 8 plus 8 plus 8, 24, and into 2 to the power 10 bytes. That means 2 to the power 34 bytes, or you can say 2 to the power 30 into 2 to the power 4, and this is GB. Okay, 2 to the power 30 means GB. So 16 gigabytes will be the size of the file. If the question was only about double indirect, let us say there is no triple indirect. Okay, forget this. Let us say triple indirect is not there. They are asking only about till double indirect. So in case of double indirect, you can calculate like this. 2 to the power 8 into 2 to the power 8. Simple twice. Into 2 to the power 10. That will be 2 to the power 20. 6, that means 2 to the power 26 byte, that means 2 to the power 6 into 2 to the power 20. 2 to the power 20 means 1 MB. 64 MB will be the answer if double indirect is there. If single indirect is there, only there is only single indirect, then in this case once. Single means multiply by only once, number of pointers into size of the block. That means 2 to the power 8 means 256 KB. So after solving this question, I realized I have solved one question wrongly, and that question was, so we have to go back to that question and we have to correct it. So I solved one question, this one. This question I solved wrongly. Actually, they are asking about the triple double indirect. I think there is no triple indirect in this. So they are asking about the file size has 256 bytes blocks and 2 bytes 4 disk address. The maximum possible size of this file system, 12 direct, 1 indirect, and one double indirect. So there are only till double indirect. So number of pointers per block are 128 pointers. That means 2 to the power 7 pointers. So answer is of this question will be 2 to the power 7 into 2 to the power 7 into the size of each block is 256. That means 2 to the power 8. So this will become 4 plus 4, 7 plus 7, 14, 14 plus 8, 22. Okay. So 27 plus 7 14, 14 plus 8 22, that means 2 to the power 22 bytes, or you can say 4 MB. Okay, 4 MB is not in the answer, so let us calculate for single indirect also. Single indirect will be 2 to the power 7 into 2 to the power 8, that means 2 to the power 15. Okay, and this will be simply 32 KB. Okay, for 12 direct pointers, it will be 12 into 256, that means it will be 3 into 2 to the power 4, or you can say 1024 into 3, or 3 KB. Okay, for direct pointers, it will be 3 KB. So it will be 4 MB. Answer will be 4 MB actually for this question. Okay, this answer, this 2 to the power 29 will be for triple indirect. So this is triple indirect. I solved it triple indirect. Actually, it will be solved till now here, till here only. Okay, so the answer will be 4 MB for this question. 4 MB plus 35 KB. Okay, you can neglect it because this is the lower terms. So none of the option actually matching. Options are still wrong. But the question will be, answer will be 4 MB only for this question. Okay, so we have solved these questions. And now next question is this.